Thank you very much for this honor. I know I don't deserve it, and I know there are hundreds of lecturers and professors at JCU that deserve it. Thank you very much. So I would like to acknowledge Australian Aboriginal people and Torres Strait Islander people as the first inhabitants of the nation, and acknowledge traditional owners of the lands where our staff, students live, learn, and work. I would also like very, very much to show my respect to Professor Rick Spear, Professor Wayne Melrose, Alex Lucas from Cairns, and John Crowes for their dedication and work on parasites, especially hookworms. And yeah. So by no means I should be the outstanding lecturer, because my lectures are really like those. And every time I start talking about parasites, that is the reaction I get from audience. It seems that today it's a little different. So, and I have to be tough and go on, because I'm paid to teach. And also the students, they have this kind of reaction. They are overwhelmed by the number of parasites, they consider parasites boring and ugly. And there was a protest of the parasites that I supported, because they think they are beautiful, interesting, and helpful for their study. Really, they are like that. And so, on the lectures, there will be disturbing images. This is a photo of a louse that was provided by Professor Rick Spear. You can see, and it looks like that fellow. It is really a very, very tough and successful parasite. That alien, it's not me. We look the same. It's a tapeworm. That is looks like an elephant, but it's a flea, a tapeworm, anterior end of a tapeworm, a mite, a nice mosquito. So they don't look very much different from those characters from movies. And I struggle with students when their feedback like that. And not too much audience. This is a very, very, very successful parasite as well. It's a Phyllis, Ctenocephalides Phyllis, and it met this fellow. And yeah, so it seems that the students like very much the analogies, and that will help them to remember some of the parasites. And what do we reckon this might be? It looks like something brought from Mars, but it's not. It's a Sarcoptes cabae in our skin. You can see the culprit here. You can see what it can do to human, sorry. Can do to humans, what it can do to animals. And so it's about scabies. And we try to, we don't like this. So the parasites are not scary, ugly, and disgusting. Who would call that mite, that Sarcoptes, as a scary and ugly creature? It's a very interesting creature. And during the night, we expect those characters to come. Some others, a mite comes, it takes control. And this is the Romanesus gallinae, a mite that will feed on poultry and humans during the night. You can see the mite here during the night. And we have problems in controlling really this mite, because those things, they don't work. And very, very, very pathogenic mite. It can affect, it really has this effect on the birds and also on humans, very, very painful bites. And because of this, JC, occupational health and safety, require our students to wear that protective suit when they enter chicken sheds. And because Vice Chancellor mentioned about hemonchus, this is the stomach of a sheep that died because of infection with hemonchus. Those were clinical signs. How many parasites we recovered? The thousands, tens of thousands of parasites. So it is barber's pole worm. What is new about this parasite? You can see the tooth here, that's not new. That is the morphology of the female, beautiful morphology, nothing new. This is how the female worms look like, and that aspect gave them the name of barber's pole worm. And this is the new, barber's pole. And this is an updated version of myself. Yeah, they were preparing for a lab crawl. So, can we make the parasites like this? Really, we? And so we turn from this to this, and we can organize an exhibition. Oh, it's not Louvre, it's JCU 2020. There will be drug references and drug use. Violence and cruelty against parasites. Students will be taught how to fight parasites. And we recommend gym attendance, and JCU gym is helping us by giving a 10% discount. And we have a history of violence against parasites. It seems this is the way we started to fight against ticks in China. This happened in France, duel. This is what we are doing nowadays. Very often the parasites will become arrested in the body of the host. And also this is the outcome, very, very often. But neither me nor JCU endorses violence or cruelty against parasites. And I want to tell you that 4 out of the 5 best sold drugs, veterinary drugs sold in the world, they are used to treat parasites. So it is fipronil, imidacloprid for ticks and fleas, for ticks and fleas. And ivermectin and milbemycin for heartworms. There will be nudity, sex references. You can see a female and a male hookworm. They are in the intestine, feeding, mating at the same time. And we know that for never was a story of more vow than that of Juliet and her Romeo. There was an older one. Yeah. So it is the love story of Cystosoma. And who is Cystosoma? Cystosoma, there are parasites that locate in the blood vessels, and male is always, or almost always coupled with the female. Unfortunately, they do very, very severe pathology to humans. Bad English? My English? Really? So, because of disturbing images, violence, drug references, bad English, this presentation has been rated PG, so I hope your parents know where you are, what you are doing. And we are going to start talking about hookworms. This is the mouth, the anterior end of a hookworm. You can see big mouth, very sharp teeth that looks like this one, but it behaves by far worse. So this is an intestine of a puppy, that, of a dog that died, and it was brought to JCU. You can see the intestine is full of blood. Again, here, intestine of a puppy that died. We can see tens, hundreds of parasites. You might ask yourself how they are doing that. So we can see teeth, we can see taking bites of the mucosa, opening blood vessels, feeding on blood. So hookworms, and we are going to talk about teeth, blood, and tears. And this fellow that was attacked by a shark, after he has seen what hookworms can do, declared this. So we start talking about hookworms in dogs, and they are very, 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 very important parasites. And common parasites, especially in tropical and subtropical areas, you can see them there. They locate as adults in the small intestine of the dogs. They are attached to the mucosa, as you can see with the mouth. They feed on blood. And in infections with Ankylostoma caninum, puppies younger than 2-3 weeks can suddenly die. Dogs can be infected by 4 species of hookworms. It is Ankylostoma caninum. They are as big as 2 centimeters, the females. The anterior end, the mouth is big, provided with 3 pairs of teeth on the ventral margin. Brasiliense and Ceylanicum that have also a big mouth, but provided only with 2 teeth. The median teeth is smaller. And Uncinaria stenocephala, again, big mouth, but this time with cutting plates instead of teeth. By far the most important, most common, most dangerous hookworm of dogs is represented by Ankylostoma caninum. It will be the focus of our presentation. And what is the significance of hookworms that infect dogs for human health? Ankylostoma ceylanicum and Ankylostoma caninum can infect and develop as adults in the intestine of humans. The discovery that Ankylostoma caninum can mature in the small intestine of humans was done in Townsville in 1988, when 93 people were suffering from severe abdominal pain, diarrhea, weight loss. And at that time, Paul Prosiv and John Crowes found out, as you can see here, those humans were infected with adult worms of Ankylostoma caninum. So that is about adults. What about the juveniles? Juveniles, they also behave very badly towards humans, like father, like son. So larvae of dog hookworms, especially Brasiliense, they cause a condition that is called cutaneous larval migrans. It's very, very common in South America, Caribbean. What is that? You can see here. We can see red and twisting, very, very, very itchy skin eruption. It is caused by migration of the larvae through the skin, penetration and migration of the larvae through the skin of humans. Fortunately, now they also have a good effect on human health. And researchers from Cairns, they do a lot of work, beautiful, brilliant work. So because hookworms can regulate the immune response of the host, products, peptides that are produced by the hookworms, they are experimentally used to treat allergic and autoimmune diseases in animals and humans. How are we going to recognize a hookworm? So why they are called hookworms? The anterior end is bent dorsally, as you can see here and here, like a hook. Big mouth, teeth, and the 3 pairs of teeth, and also in the depth of the buccal capsule, there are another 2 triangular sharp teeth. They can live in the small intestine of the host for up to 2 years. Eggs, they are thin-shelled, many cells inside. The female worms are very prolific. They can lay up to 30,000 eggs per day. So this is about the ID of the culprit. Now we are going to talk about the life of the culprit. Adult females that locate in the small intestine of the host, they will lay eggs. Fortunately, those eggs, they are not infected for another host. So they have to spend some time in the environment and they require conditions of temperature, moisture, and aeration. If they don't have those conditions, and if the feces are removed periodically, we can prevent infection with this parasite. So what will happen in the environment? Eggs will be shed, they will get into the environment. If they have proper temperature, moisture, inside eggs, a larva will develop, larvae will hatch. They will feed, as you can see here, one bacteria from environment. This is the digest, the gut of a larva, full of bacteria. They will molt, they will change to second stage larva, and after that, third stage larva. The third stage larva, it is the stage that will infect the host. Unfortunately for them, unfortunately for us, third stage larvae, they can't feed. And so they have to be very, very careful with how they use their nutrients, because they can't, if they move too much, if they waste their nutrients, they will die very, very quickly. So that development depends on temperature, humidity, and oxygen. On the other side, the survival of third stage larvae in the environment depends also on the temperature and the humidity of the environment. So why the Ankylostoma carinum is very common in tropical and subtropical areas? Because optimum temperature for development, it is 25-35 degrees. At this interval of time, the infective stage, the third stage larvae, will be reached in 2 to 5 days. The minimum temperature they can develop is 15 degrees. At 15 degrees, the development, if they develop, will take around 3 weeks. The larvae won't develop at temperatures lower than 15 degrees. The lowest temperature the parasites can develop will determine the geographical distribution of the parasites. So imagine the environment will become contaminated with third stage larvae, and the host, the dogs, will become dogs, humans, other species will become infected with third stage larvae from environment. It will be good to know which factors are favorable for the development and survival of the larvae in the environment. So it is good if we remember that the females lay large numbers of eggs, 30,000 per day. A puppy that is infected with the hookworms can shed in the environment up to 5 million eggs per day. Populations of larvae will bloom when the weather conditions will favor the development and survival of the larvae. In temperate areas, disease, clinical signs are common during the warm seasons. In tropical areas like us here, clinical signs will be more common, and the dogs will shed more eggs in the wet seasons. Infections will be very, very common in dogs that live in communities, in dogs that are restricted, that are crowded, dogs that are walked on grass or earth runs. Why? Because there will be moisture there. There will be and very common also when the bedding is soiled and feces are allowed to accumulate. They are not removed periodically. And also very, very important, no regular treatment. In Townsville, at least 60-70% of the dogs, if they are not regularly treated, they are infected with hookworms, irrespective of the age of the dogs. So L3 will be in the environment, they will contaminate in the environment. So how long are those larvae to survive in the environment? In the laboratory, they can survive up to 7 months. Luckily, in the environment, they won't survive as long as that. It seems they can survive up to 6-7 weeks. And they will survive only when the environment, the soil, is moist, the temperature is between 5 and 27 degrees, and they are protected from sunlight. They will be killed by temperatures lower than 0 degrees, drying and exposure to sunlight. Dryness are probably their main enemies. They will survive least on concrete and longest on the soil that is covered with pasture. So they prefer moist, shady places. So we got here, so larvae are in the environment. How do we reckon they are going to gain access to the host? They have two ways. They can infect the host either via the skin or after they are ingested orally. It doesn't matter the way the host infect the host, they will mature in the small intestine of the dogs. For those larvae that will actively penetrate the skin, they will migrate, after that they will migrate via blood to heart, they will get to the lungs. In the lungs they will be found in the capillaries, they will break the capillaries and they will get into the alveoles. From alveoles, they will get into the bronchi, trachea, pharynx, they will be swallowed and get into the small intestine. That journey will take about 1 week. After they get to the intestine, they will feed, they will grow, and they will become fully adults in about 4 weeks. So that dog will shed eggs in about 4 weeks after it became infected. If the dogs become infected after ingestion of the larvae, larvae won't migrate, most of them they won't migrate. They might enter, they will enter the wall of the digestive tract, they will stay there for a couple of days, they will return to the intestine where they are going to mature. So, some of the larvae, after they enter the host, they won't turn into adults, as I mentioned before. They will be forever young. What will happen? They will migrate to various tissues. They will, in large numbers, they will be in the muscles, in the skin, they might be in the kidneys, and they will enter a process called arrested development. What will happen? They will become quiescent, their metabolism will be very, very, very low, they won't make too much exchange with the host, and they can survive there for many months, probably years. So larvae will join arrested development. It is important to know which factors will influence the migration of the development of the larvae, intestinal versus somatic. And age and resistance are the most important. The larvae are very, very likely to migrate and to turn into adults in young animals, 3 to 6 months, younger than that. The older the animals become, the more larvae will follow this somatic, that arrested development. Do you reckon they are going to be lost? No, they are not going to be lost for the species. So the arrested larvae, as you can see them here, will become reactivated when, if that is a female dog, the hormonal changes that will occur during the pregnancy will be a signal for the larvae to become reactivated. The larvae will migrate to the mammary gland and they will infect the puppies via milk. It's an infection that puppies can't avoid. One thing, that it is at that age, they are very, 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 very susceptible and very, very to this infection. So, larvae, we said, they will be in the body of the dog. If it is a female, during the pregnancy, the larvae will become reactivated, they will migrate to the mammary gland, and they will be transferred to the puppies via milk. That transmammary infection will depend on female dogs turning into a kind of reservoir of larvae. So imagine they will be in a contaminated environment, they will become infected with larvae from the environment, but those larvae won't turn into adults, they will accumulate into the body of that female dog. When that female dog will become pregnant, the larvae will be reactivated, transferred to puppies via milk. Some of the larvae will become reactivated and they will migrate to the intestine of that female dog as well. So they will mature there. Very, very important, once a female dog becomes infected, it can transmit larvae via milk for at least 3 lactations. Very, very important, the drugs, they are not effective against larvae that are hypobiotic, that are in that arrested development. The effectors of the immune response, they have a very, very low efficacy against those larvae. So how are the dogs, how can they become infected with ankylostoma caninum? You are going to see that there are many ways. We talked about, so larvae will be in the environment, they can infect the host via the skin, orally, with L3 from environment, L3 from milk, and another way it is with L3 from transport host. What are the transport hosts? So if we imagine the environment that is contaminated, it is very likely the dogs will become infected because they will offer the larvae from environment specific stimuli that will activate the larvae. But at the same time, in the environment, there might be mice, there might be rats, there might be birds. Those larvae can infect them as well. What will happen with those larvae that infect the transport host? They will survive. They will migrate to muscle, as you can see here, kidneys, other tissues, and they will enter hypobiosis, that arrested development. If that mouse, if that rat becomes ingested by a dog, those larvae will infect the dog. So, on the other end, flies, cockroaches can be carriers for larvae of Ankylostoma caninum. Unlike Ankylostoma caninum, Ankylostoma brasiliensis, ceylanicum, and Uncinaria stenocephala, they can infect the host only via the skin, orally, ingestion of L3 and ingestion of transport host, but there is no transmammary infection. Do you have questions? I haven't finished, so just if you have short questions about the morphology and the life of this culprit. Because from morphology and life cycle, we are going to talk about epidemiology, after that pathology, and so on. No questions. So, distribution. Ankylostoma caninum is common in tropical and subtropical areas. In Australia, it is present in all states except Tasmania. In 70s and 80s, the prevalence of the parasite was 80% in Cairns, 70%, probably 100% also in Townsville, Brisbane 70%, Sydney 36%, and Victoria and Adelaide only 2%. Nowadays, very, very low prevalence, significantly lower, around or less than 11%. Brasiliense, Northern Australia, the optimum temperature, it is higher, a little higher than that of Ankylostoma caninum. Ceylanicum also Northern Australia, and Uncinaria, Victoria, common in Victoria and Tasmania. Why? Because the optimum temperature for Uncinaria stenocephala is 20 degrees Celsius, and the larval stages of Uncinaria can survive temperatures like 0 degrees or 5 degrees. Infections with hookworms may occur in dogs of all ages, and we have seen that. That is very common up here in Townsville. However, clinical signs, so all dogs of all ages will have hookworms in their intestine if they are not treated regularly. But clinical signs we can see only in young animals. Younger than 1 year, very, very common in unweaned dogs and dogs up to 3-4 months. How is that? In endemic areas, the worms are very common, the dogs will become infected, that will stimulate a protective immune response. But that protective immune response is not bulletproof. Some parasites will develop, they can survive, the toughest parasites will survive within that host that developed a protective immune response. On the top of that, an age resistance will also develop in animals, in dogs. In females that are older than 8 months, and in males that are older than 11 months. How is that possible? So as you can see here, we did some trials, huge infiltrations with all kinds of immune cells in the intestine of the dogs. However, none of them will react to the hookworms, as you can see here, no matter if they are between the villi or if they migrate through the intestine and get even deep to close to muscularis mucosa. So it seems that the hookworms, they will create a privileged site around themselves. They can survive very well there. Pathogenesis will depend on the species. Ankylostomach anion is by far, as mentioned before, more pathogenic than the Brazilian Seuncinaria stenocephala or Ceylanicum. Number of parasites, 100 parasites in pups that are infected via the milk with Ankylostomach anionum is fatal. It will depend also on the age. I mentioned about that before. It will depend also on the protective immune response. These things will make the disease, as mentioned before, common in young animals. It depends also on the iron reserves, the nutrition, the stress. Puppies are very, very, very susceptible because they can't make up, they can't compensate for the loss of the blood, loss of iron, proteins, and so on. So we know about the culprit, we know how it behaves in the host, where they migrate. We should know now about the pathology. So where can we expect pathology? We can expect pathology at the site of larval penetration. We said they will penetrate the skin. During larval migration, the most important will be in the lungs, and the very, very, very pathogenic, they will be in the intestine. What can we see here? A larva migrating through the skin, and those are some of the lesions that we can see in dogs that become infected via the skin. What can we see? We can see alopecia, congestion, pruritus, purpules, and so on. When they get, the larva will get to the lungs, they will be in the capillaries, they will break the capillaries, they will get into alveoles and up to the bronchi and trachea. When they open the capillaries, they will cause hemorrhage, edema, inflammation, and also there might be some bacterial complications. By far, the worst part of the pathology will occur in the small intestine. Juveniles and adults will attach, as you can see, to the mucosa, take a bite, take a plug of the mucosa, digest it, swallow, and take another bite. The digestion will occur, will take only 10 to 13 minutes. Very, very important, the worms will change places of attachment 4 to 6 times a day. What will happen? They will stay here, they will move to another place. They will leave behind what? Bleeding places. At the same time, a lot of blood will flow around the head of the parasite. And very, very important, large quantities of blood will pass rapidly through the gut of the worms. Very, very, very large amounts of blood will pass I don't think there is an explanation for that. It seems that the parasites will use the oxygen from the blood. The host might lose up to 0.2 milliliters blood per day in infections with Ankylostomach anionum. And very, very important, the blood loss will start 8 days after infection. I mentioned before, the parasites, the worms will become adults only 2-3 weeks after infection. However, the clinical signs, severe clinical signs, and pathology will occur much earlier. Somebody said we should consider a hookworm, especially Ankylostomach anionum, that is feeding on the mucosa of the small intestine. We should consider that as an open blood vessel. Because of that, we are going to have anemia, and the host will lose a lot of iron, proteins, and so on. From those pathology, clinical signs, the clinical signs will appear in pups from second week after birth. There will be anemia, as you can see here, bloody feces, weakness, sudden death if they are young. There might be also some respiratory signs caused by larval damage in the lungs, and also some skin pathology. How are we going to diagnose infections with hookworms? Clinical signs, they are pretty specific, bloody diarrhea and anemia. History, age, we said puppies. Epidemiology will be also very important, area, time of the year, overcrowding, poor hygiene, and so on, and identification of the eggs in the feces to confirm the diagnosis. We are going to have a problem because we might have severe disease that is caused by immature parasites and they won't lay eggs. The second problem will be, as mentioned before, we said dogs of all ages can become infected. They might shed eggs in the environment and we can find them in the feces. So we have to make an interpretation considering the age, considering the clinical signs and number of eggs that we find. Very, very important, the disease might be suspected in the absence of eggs in the feces. So if they are puppies, we have diarrhea with blood, we exclude parvovirus infection, it is hookworm. After the animals die, the diagnosis can be easily, but we shouldn't get there, easily by clinical signs and visualization of the worms. This is a case that happened in JCU 2016. Parvovirus was excluded. What the fifth year students thought it was hookworms. However, they couldn't find any worms there with the microscopic examination. They couldn't find any eggs in the feces and in the content. So what we had to do, we checked very carefully the content and we found out that the worms were immature. Treatment. In severely affected animals, we have two objectives. It is an emergency. We have to eliminate the worms as quickly as possible. And at the same time, we have to combine anthelminthic therapy with blood transfusions and iron and fluid therapy. So in that, in an animal that we are going to have those stages, we are going to have adult parasites in the small intestine, feeding, causing pathology. Luckily, most drugs that are on the market, they are effective against stages that are in the lumen of the intestine. We might have migrating larvae. Not all the drugs will be effective against migrating larvae. So that's why we should repeat the treatment 2-3 weeks later. And we are going to have arrested larvae that are resistant to therapy. There are no drugs that we know that they are effective against them. There are tens of active ingredients, and when it comes to commercial drugs, there might be thousands of commercial drugs that are effective against hookworms in Australia. That is confusing and very for students. I won't talk about that. In the last 4 minutes, I would like to talk about prevention because that is very important. So we can prevent the disease if we focus on the puppies, if we focus on the female dogs, and if we focus on the adult dogs. For the puppies, we have two objectives. We have to prevent clinical disease in puppies that can be infected via milk, and we have to prevent the contamination of the environment with eggs that will be shed by those puppies. How we can prevent that? We treat the puppies when they are 2 weeks of age, and we treat them every 2 weeks until they are 2 months. Why we are doing that? Because the larvae can be found in the milk of the host for at least 5-6 weeks. The puppies can become infected from environment, and that's why we have to treat them every 2 weeks. When we treat the puppies, it will be good to treat the female dogs as well, because they will become infected at this time, and at this time, with the reactivation of the larvae, some of the larvae might turn into adults in their intestine. What about female dogs? We know that there will be larvae in their body. The larvae, during this time, will become reactivated. They might be transferred to the puppies. Most anthelmintics that are on the market, they won't be effective against inhibited larvae. Experimentally, the infection of the puppies can be reduced or prevented if we treat the puppies from the 40th day after pregnancy until 2 weeks post parturition, every day with benzimidazole. Nobody is doing that, and the drugs are not registered for this job. Better drugs are macrocyclic lectins. One or two treatments will prevent or will reduce the transmission of the larvae. However, they are not registered for this job either. In older dogs, it will be good if we can check if they are infected before treatment, or otherwise we can treat them every 3 or 6 months. What else we can do? We remove from time to time the feces and keep good hygiene. We said that if we remove the feces every day or every other day, the larvae won't have time to develop. If we keep the floors or runs dry, the larvae, even if they develop, they will die there. If we prevent animals from preying, that will we prevent them from getting infected from mice, rats that have larvae in their body. Regular treatments are very, very good. Avoid overcrowding, and larvae, if they are on pavements, they can be killed with 100% hypochlorite. I want to thank Jenny Elliman for printing 3D the hookworms, and Glenn Harrison for suggestions on the presentation. Thank you very much.
So we do have time for any questions or comments that you might like to make. There's one at the back there, Con. Yeah.
If we human step in dog food, how likely are we to get the chance to have this form of the worm?
So it depends how old those feces have been in the environment. So initially the larvae will develop on the surface of the feces because only there they will have oxygen. If those feces are older, they will be broken and they will be spread in the environment. The larvae will develop in that mass. So we are very, very, very likely to become infected. It takes 10 to at most 30 minutes for the larvae from the environment to penetrate our skin. Sometimes they say even 5 to 10 minutes. At the same time, those feces and the environment should be moist. If it is not moist, the larvae won't be activated. Because in the environment, they are in a quiescent state. They stay there quiet and they don't move, because if they move, they will exhaust the nutrients, they won't be infected. If they sense the host is around, if there is an increase in temperature, if there is CO2, the dogs will share CO2, they will become reactivated, they will stay on their tail, they will wave the anterior end, and that will favor the transmission to the host, including humans.
Another question or comment? Yeah? Oh, wait for the microphone so Ken's can hear. Thank you.
Wayne, I was just commenting the last section. There was a study done here in Townsville a number of years ago where a person took a hose to a pile of dog feces, and there were literally millions of larvae over about a meter diameter after that. And they're all moving around, so you can get infected really easily. Just want to make a comment about, I think his name is Solanity. Something's changed with that. It's now moved into humans in a big way. It's become one of the most common hookworms in South Asia.
Yeah.
And the real worry with that, it can actually go its full life cycle in humans and disease. So it's one of those ones in Australia you need to be very aware of, because in a northern Australian dog, it's quite a common parasite. So we may come across it more frequently.
Can I ask a question?
Please.
So, I remember Mike Howell, who was my honour supervisor in parasitology, I remember him saying that he never had a pet, a family pet, because he considered them to be parasite bags. And it seems to me that you made the case today to a certain extent. I don't know, but you know, it was interesting for me to reflect on that. What I don't remember is this, and maybe I never knew, that phase of arrested development, is there an end to that? How long can that... can it exist in that phase of arrested development?
So I talked only about female dogs, because they will transfer the larvae to puppies. It is considered that if, so they will infect also from environment, they will infect the male dogs. They might survive a couple of years, but in time they will be destroyed by the immune response. Mm-hmm. It is very likely they won't survive more than 1 or 2 years.
1 or 2 years. Yeah. Is there a question or comment from Cairns? like it. We got one here though.
Is there anything good about hookworms?
Yeah, I mentioned before. So
the
there
question
are.
Is, there question are. Is there anything good?
Yeah, there are researchers in Cairns that are trying to identify peptides that can help treatment of people with autoimmune diseases. So that is a good thing about. And I mentioned before Professor Rick Spear, he used to infect himself with hookworms, and he used to, yeah, we used to have some students, and they were purifying eggs from his, and yeah. Really? Yeah.
Another naive question then. We saw those very arresting photos of the intestine with the blood-filled intestine for puppies and whatnot. And yet we're saying humans also are infected with hookworms. So what's different? Why is it that doesn't happen to humans?
Numbers. It is numbers, because Wayne might know humans, they get infected with 10, 20 larvae. So
It's the load.
It's the number of the worms.
One of the reasons that dogs eat pieces of other dogs is that they're actually ingesting the larvae before they can hatch, and they're preventing the transmission.
No, I haven't heard about that, so. They can develop very, very quickly. It will take 2 days to develop, so. Theophilus. Sorry? Cats. Okay, so cats can also, they can be infected by Ankylostoma tuberiforme, Ceylanicum brasiliensis, and Muscinaria stenocephala. It is less prevalent than infection in dogs. And tuberiforme can't be transmitted via milk as it is transmitted caninum. So caninum in dogs, it is very, very common, very pathogenic. Many ways the dogs can become infected, so that will make it a very dangerous and common parasite.
So, on climate change, what's your prediction about how climate change is going to affect the incidence of hookworm, and maybe the risks also to humans in this one-off approach? What do you think we need to worry about, a different aspect of climate change effect?
It is very likely they'll go south, but nowadays, as I showed you, the prevalence has declined from 70-100% to less than 10%, because we have better drugs, we keep, and one very important factor is that the drugs that we use now for treatment, for prevention of heartworm disease, they are very effective against hookworms and treating the dogs for heartworm disease for prevention reduced significantly the prevalence of hookworms. However, as Wayne mentioned, we might expect in Townsville to have problems in dogs only in the wet season. It doesn't happen only that, because we irrigate, we use housing, and at least parts of the environment are moist most of the year, like the lawn, and the larvae will develop there relatively well.
Cairns, do feel free to jump in if there's somebody there that wants to say something, but we'll keep an eye on here too.
Yep, I'll be back there. This is not a pre-prepared question. Most of your talk was probably around domesticated dogs. I was just wondering if there's been any studies into dingo populations, which range from Tasmania right through to North Queensland. They're very nomadic, but is there any difference between the ancestry of dogs, or is it more a domesticated problem?
Glenn, we had a trial 5-6 years ago, and we trapped 12 dogs, I reckon. 70% of them, 80%, they were infected with hookworms. So they are very common in the populations of dingoes. I don't know. Sorry. Yeah, very good question.
And just while the microphone's coming.
Yeah.
Back,
so
you're not a fan of dog parks, then?
No.
Oh, with the grass. That's what I was thinking.
Thank you
for
excellent presentation. I have actually two questions, if I may. The first question is. Do dog owners have more potential migrants? So do you see any representation in the dog owners?
So if the dog owners are more likely to become infected with it's difficult to say. For many parasites, no, and probably for Enclostoma caninum as well. It depends on where you spend some time. If you spend some time and you walk without shoes on moist areas, you can become infected. If you go to South America or Caribbean to enjoy some time, 25% of tourists from those areas, they become infected. So it is about those dogs, not. And here the dogs, if the owner is taking care of the dogs, and generally in Australia the owners follow the vet's instructions and they treat them from time to time, they shouldn't be a problem.
And do you know whether dog owners have a lower risk of getting asthma? Because it's a theory that those germs are a problem in the
response. Yeah, I don't know if the dog's owners have asthma, they should. If they become infected with the larvae, it's very likely they won't have that asthma, but I don't know.
Thanks, Connor. I'm interested in the types of dogs. For instance, we have corgis, and I know they wouldn't have them. but I'm wondering about other more common breeds. Yeah, it's also, as you talked about the dingo, and there are some species that are kind of very pure to their origins, whereas some species have been bred over many successions, and are certain breeds more vulnerable to this?
No, as far as I know, I have never heard about breeds. Yeah, so susceptibility is not related to the breed of the dogs. It is mostly related to the age of the dogs and immunological experience of the dogs.
Any last question, last chance in Cairns? Anything there? I was sort of thinking in Cairns you have the good hookworms and
yeah.
We have the bad hookworms, it sounds like. Yeah.
No, they have the very good researchers up there.
No further comment? Well, look, I think it only means that I have the opportunity to thank you, Con.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
I think it's just been wonderful. I think we can all see why the students wanted to, without any hesitation and in overwhelming numbers compared to others, suggested that Con should be our last lecturer for 2018. Thank you very much, Con.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you.